It's an energetic, romantic fantasy of three people's lives.
The true crux about the story is the dilemma that each of those characters, Arthur, Guinevere, and Lancelot, find themselves in.
I think that that is where the story, for me, reflects on all of us. It is that we are given something which is our particular thing to learn and our particular path, and it's just as important to fail as it is to succeed.
Whether you agree with it or not, it's very clear that ultimately truth and justice and right will prevail, will triumph.
Up! Up!
Arthur is a natural leader and must be in every frame of the film a natural leader, not just by the words that come out of his mouth or his actions, but by the kind of person he is.
Lady Guinevere of Lyonesse, welcome to Camelot.
King Arthur is a man who, through his experience of life, is far more mature than Lancelot. He's a man that, through his experience, he knows what to do in a given situation. He's a great leader, he's a great father figure.
All Lyonesse will want to know if you've arrived safely. John here will take any message you care to send.
My lord grants my wishes even before I speak them. Tell my people I've come safe into my new country. Tell them you saw my eyes filled with tears of joy.
Already a queen.
It identifies with the human life and the what we'd like to think is the order of things, that there is somebody really with sufficient wisdom that also has a combination of that with action, that can do something.
He comes from not just a position of strength in terms of having the biggest army or democracy that he allows the Council of the Round Table to participate in decisions, or that he listens to his people, but also he knows what God expects of him.
I named it Camelot.
There's always a little sort of moral in these tales, and it's like even the myths and the Greeks are the same. I mean, they set them up and then they give them an Achilles heel. Otherwise, how can anybody on the human level identify with them or understand what they're all about? I mean, it's really only an attempt to establish or set a precedent and standard to adhere to or aspire to.
I think he's also someone who probably hasn't loved a woman in the way he wishes to love Guinevere and be loved back by Guinevere.
In all the stories about King Arthur, the one thing which is always constant, no matter how much the stories might differ in the telling, is Arthur's wisdom. He keeps coming out again and again and again. And I think he ruled by charm and wisdom rather than you do what I tell you.
He's a man who follows the path of responsibility and who is guided strongly by morality.
So he works out the idea of a round table where even he doesn't sit at the head. Everybody's equal. And that's a pretty heady mixture to follow. And of course, everybody wants to live up to that ideal. So I think, from my point of view, my character follows him for those reasons. And also because he's Sean Connery and he's the ideal person to play the part.
There's many great actors out there, but when you think of King Arthur, no one comes to mind like Sean. And even though there's a little bit of age difference, Sean still has that sparkle in his eyes, and there's a great maturity about Julia. And obviously, love transcends. You know, passion, love, electricity, it transcends all age differences anyway.
Arthur is a man who's devoted his life to service, and now, for the first time in his life, wants to be loved, and wants that feeling, wants to love and be loved, and for the first time has met someone who he feels love for.
You don't have to marry me because your father wanted it, or because your country needs it. Camelot will protect Lyonesse, whether you marry me or not.
His only way to find out how she truly feels is to offer her the out by saying that he will protect Lyonesse.
You don't know what it means to me to
to hear you say that.
So, you want to be released from the engagement?
It's quite important for the story that you understand that these two people come together because they love each other. It's not just a marriage of convenience.
No. I want to marry you. Not your crown, just you.
Just me?
Yes.
And I think she likes his gentleness. I do think she loves him. And with Sean playing the part, I don't think it's a problem.
Marry the king, Guinevere. But love the man.
I only know one way to love, my lord. And that is body and heart and soul.
She's a lady of Lyonesse, and so therefore she has had all the accoutrements of duty, the state, what you're expected, the correct procedures, you know, that are very difficult to live by.
I would describe her character as somebody who was fairly intuitive, fairly feisty, with a strong sense of responsibility, and it's her sense of responsibility and the antagonism that goes between her kind of like just wanting to go out and enjoy life that is a constant theme through the film and pulls her in different directions and towards the two different men.
Dad! Okay, good.
She's in love by her mind and duty to Arthur, but she's emotionally in love with Lancelot. So as he says, you know, yeah, your will chooses me, but your heart chooses him. So then that's her dilemma.
It is a dilemma between two very strong and attractive men. This isn't one of those movies where one of the guys is clearly the one we're all rooting for her not to be with. It's a strong pull in both directions.
It's like she has a view into another world through that. She kind of balks at because she can't take it. She can't take up that opportunity because of what she has committed herself to. And she knows that by marrying Arthur, she can serve her people better.
She's caught between someone she has a great attraction for and somebody that she owes a great deal to and is young and handsome and romantic. And her love for Arthur, her obligation to her people, and to fulfill the role of Queen of Camelot.
Gere met her a year ago, actually. I mean, a year before we came over here last March, or really a year before that, for this role, you know. And he fell in love with her. And when I first started working on the movie, he said, I think we already have Guinevere. I said, you're kidding. He said, I met this woman. I think she's great. She was one of the first people we met when we came over here in March. And it was just, this is it. You know, she had the right age, the right maturity, great look, great actress. She just brought so much to it that it was a very easy decision to make.
I'm very lucky that a Julia Ormond existed. She is a brilliant actress, and she's very strong, able to stand up to both men. In a movie like this, if you don't understand why both men want her, the movie doesn't work, and there's no question about that. And also, by the way, she happens to be gorgeous, and not just gorgeous, but wholesome, down to earth, beautiful.
If you were free to do as you pleased, would you marry Arthur?
I am free. As free as you are.
Prove it.
How?
Forget who you are. Let all the world go away. And all the people in it. But you. Me. Do what you want to do.
It creates friction, but it's also there's also a sense of opposites attracting. And so I think they very much are attracted to their missing parts that they see in each other. Arthur, from the very beginning, senses something in Lancelot, something special, something that may be of use to him one day, but he doesn't really know what. It's been an amazing thing all along that Richard does his own sword fighting and his own horseback riding and his own gauntlet running. And sort of before we started, we had all this preparation for figuring out how we would do it with stunt people and doubling him and having wigs made and extra sets of clothing and everything. And Richard just does everything.
Great.
One and three.
All right, check it.
He's not using stuntman. He's doing all his own stuff, and he's tapped in wonderfully to it coming from his center, being an energy that he releases and controls as it comes out. And I think that's something quite close to Richard's own persona.
We didn't want to fabricate some big battle. It felt kind of hokey. So Bill one day said, how about if he runs a gauntlet? And he just started describing this thing, and I thought it was great.
The gauntlet is a test which Lancelot passes with fine colors, which no one else has passed. And I think in terms of modern day life, it's his individual test. And when he has passed it, he is rewarded with something at the end and passes an even greater test in the way that he deals with that. It's his first act, or one of his first acts that you see in the film, of chivalry.
I dare not kiss so lovely a lady. I only have one heart to lose.
Yeah!
There is something knightly about him. He's a rough diamond. And maybe could do with a bit of polishing, perhaps, but he's a diamond, but all the same.
The choice of Lancelot is totally understandable because of the qualities that he does possess. The things that he, like the running of the gauntlet, no one's ever done it before. He does it without armor.
What I offer is no life of privilege, but a life of service. And if you want it, it's yours, with all my heart.
Sire, we don't know anything about him. They say he fights for money.
Sire, perhaps we should discuss
this. Enough! What do you say? Will you join us?
The guy's life is kind of aimless, pointless, no goals, no wealth, but he's a terrific swordsman. Why is he so terrific? Because he has no fear, because he doesn't care if he lives or dies. Well, that's a pretty good premise for somebody who's quite remarkable material.
Among you, I have found something that I want more than freedom. I no longer know what life I am to live, only that it would break my heart to leave you.
Oh, bravo. Then you'll join us.
Yes.
And she has a duty, being the Lady of Lyonesse, you know, and accepting that. And when you find Lancelot, who really doesn't have a direction in life, but he wants to, but he doesn't know it, and how King Arthur and Guinevere kind of bring this out in him, that life is fuller if you have a duty and a responsibility and do give something back and not be just for yourself, but it's more fun when you kind of take the whole world under your, you know, and work at it as a team. You know, that's kind of what the object of Camelot is. Everyone serves each other.
Brother to brother, yours in life and death.
That's very nice, that the arc that Lancelot gets to go through King Arthur and through Guinevere, at the same time being in love with a woman he knows he can't have.
Prince Maligant is here at my invitation.
Maligant is the classic Lucifer character that wanted to be king.
May I congratulate the king on his forthcoming marriage?
He wanted the power himself, so he left to form his own place that he could rule.
I see my place hasn't been taken yet.
But it's a place of outlaws who would like to take over first Lyonesse and later Camelot.
Well, I think he's perfectly reasonable. No, he's a terror. And it's difficult really to play the out-and-out vicious and sadistic tyrant, as opposed to, let us say, the likable rogue, and I'm trying to kind of steer a middle course there.
Maligant's a very powerful man. He's very psychologically a very powerful guy, and he kind of epitomizes everything that someone like Ralph admires. He has the power to get this army together, and he has the power to give Ralph what he wants, which is the ability to take his posse and go kill people.
What's this? Your dress is torn. Ralph? Yes, my prince. I gave orders that the lady was not to be harmed.
But my prince, I didn't...
He wants to rule the world, you know, like any archvillain, or at least the world as defined in those days. And whatever he says about how he is here to liberate people and set them free from Arthur's benign tyranny, there's no doubt that he would replace it with something much more iron-fisted.
He's an evil bastard. Malignant's the sort of, he's the sort of knight gone wrong. Really, he's somebody who abuses his power, who's been given a gift, who has great talent, who has all of the things that knights of the Round Table have, and who turns against it and goes for the greed and goes for the power and takes a different path.
A little bit more there, right.
As I turn to look at these guys,
that's a good idea. Yeah. Let's do that. Okay, we're going to do a pickup.
I'm playing him as a kind of Lucifer character. He was the angel on the right-hand side of God, and he fell from grace. And he still hankers after the Round Table and that life, but nevertheless he's driven by ambitions to power and subjugating people.
Maligot wants the beauty of Camelot and all of its people, but he wants to control it, he wants to own it. Where Arthur explains to us, it's nothing you control. It's a belief. It's an idea. It's a giving. It's something that's in the spirit. You know, not one person controls it. It's controlled by the people who inhabit it. One person. You know, so Malignant never gets it. You know, that's why he's the villain.
This is what's called an oubliette. That's French for a place of forgetting. Your quarters, my lady. No gates. No bars, no locks. Just walls of air.
Lyonesse is a place that is particularly lush and feminine and soft and green. And the slate mine is hard and sharp and edgy. And it's like going into the slate mine was like going into the darker side of somebody's mind. Perfect home for Malignant, and it's a perfect sort of place where evil comes out of.
Apparently it's the largest open cast slate mine in the country, if not the world, and this was chosen as the location for my castle because it's very, very decadent, and it looks like the sort of subterranean labyrinth underneath the castle because we assume that the one actually above ground is in ruins.
Script said Malignant's castle. I said we've had corny castles in God knows how many films. If we're going to Wales, there are slate pits here. Take Malignant underground, cavernous, another strange, strange world for this man. And that's the intention, visual intention. But it's not visual, because our job is to produce the visual in order to make it work emotionally for the director and obviously for the artists, the characters.